Welcome. We certainly want to welcome the families of the Hawaiian Islands and our prime viewers around the world to the Thriving Women Network special, Empowering Maui. Our mission is to enlighten you on the events that led up to the series of wildfires that broke out in the state of Hawaii, predominantly on the island of Maui. We want to encourage you to support organizations like the Hungry Homeless Heroes Hawaii that prepares hundreds of meals a day, hundreds of amazing individuals who garden, cook, and deliver meals directly into the hands of unsheltered heroes, and the Maui Strong Fund, which provides communities with resources for disaster preparedness, response, and recovery. The fund is being deployed to support Maui residents affected by the wildfires of Maui. Last but not least, today we will share empowering stories of people that are Maui strong, that are sharing their time, finances, and resources to improve the quality of the lives of those they care about. My name is Sabrina Protic, and I am streaming live from Brandon, Florida, as our state here is going through, as we speak, Hurricane Idalia. I'm honored to host this special with my friend and Maui resident, Ms. CJ Grace. And CJ, I want to thank you for bringing these empowering stories to our viewers. But before we begin, before we do this, let's take a deep dive into our topic, Empowering Maui. How was your week?
Well, you know, Sabrina, I really should ask you how your week has been, because you've been facing evacuations and a Category 3 hurricane. So how have you been doing with that, and how is your family bearing up?
Well, CJ, this came up so quickly. As we began to unfold about the fires, I was out of town. I arrived Sunday night, and Monday morning we were getting alerts on our phone that a hurricane was coming. So it was a quick shift. Everybody's running out to get food, water supplies, to hunker down. My sister had to evacuate. She's about 45 minutes away. She still evacuated because of the storm surge. And state of Florida is on top of everything. We've got great evacuation zones. We'll be talking about some of that with the Maui fires, as I read a lot of the research and how important notification is. Because we were notified, we were all able to become prepared and knew when we needed to leave. We've had minute by minute updates. Where I am right now, it's rain, it's wind, but we're not in danger. But only 30 minutes away, we've got people that are underwater. So yes, a lot of areas, low-lying areas are underwater, but we are safe. Nothing compared to Maui. And I just can't wait to hear more about how you've been dealing with that. So how has your week been?
Well, we've been dealing with the aftermath of the fires. And there's a lot that went on there. During the first days of August, we had a multitude of minor brush fires that affected the Hawaiian Islands. There were fires on the island of Oahu, which stretched the fire department resources there, but were apparently quickly contained by August the 4th. But then on August the 7th, we had more problems, and the National Weather Service's offices in Honolulu issued a red flag warning for portions of all the islands until the morning of August the 9th, highlighting that very dry fuels combined with strong and gusty easterly winds and low humidities could produce critical fire weather conditions with gusts of up to 60 miles an hour. And you can see that map on the screen there. That was showing the number of fires ignited on Maui. There were three main areas, actually, that were affected. One was the town of Lahaina, one was Kula, and then there was another fire that was threatening Kihei, which is the area where I live. And some people close to me were ordered to evacuate. I was fortunate enough not to have an evacuation notice, but fires affected quite a lot of the island. And what we had was a 30-acre brush fire reported adjacent to Kahului Airport in a field. We had intense winds knocking down utility poles. We had a lot of different things going on. And because of the down poles and the wind, there were many power outages. And you can see that picture there shows the devastation in the town of Lahaina, which was pretty much completely destroyed. But then you'd have weird anomalies like we just saw that previous picture where one house with a red roof survived. And here you see all the cars that were, it was almost like they melted in the fire there. Absolutely devastating conditions, something that we had never seen before. It was almost like a war zone on our own doorstep. It was incredibly fast that the fire came, and it was very, very damaging. It was, and a lot of people had absolutely no notice of what was going on. So, Sabrina, what were your thoughts about this event when you heard about it?
Oh my goodness, complete devastation. Because when I think about Hawaii, I don't think about disaster. I don't think about devastation. It takes me to a place in my mind where it's peace and rest and beauty and water and greenery and nature. So to hear that there's devastation and fires and a place that I go to relax my mind, it's mind-blowing to me that something could be happening in such a beautiful, and I call a protected area. And I'm still trying to process this in my mind, that something like this could happen in a beautiful, what I call nature home away from home, because I've been to Hawaii and I'm still trying to process it. It doesn't feel real to me, even though I see the video footage.
Well, what actually happened in Lahaina was that there was a 3-acre brush fire reported at 6:37 a.m., apparently sparked by a downed power line. And evacuations were ordered in the areas around that school. It was Lahaina Luna High School that was the first area near there was the first fire. And the firemen reckoned that they'd put it out and then had to go off and fight fires in Kula and near Kihei. So they were spread pretty thin, dealing with three different areas at once. And so because of the fires in Lahaina near the high school, the schools were closed and the children were either sent home or told not to even come in. So a lot of kids were at home, and that was an issue because that meant that there were kids who were potentially on their own at home when the fires broke out in Lahaina town. And because we had no electricity and no cell signal and the sirens didn't go off, in some ways, the people in Lahaina town were sitting ducks. They didn't, you know, they didn't have any warning. And there was bumper to bumper traffic trying to get out of the town during that time. Survivors said that they either got stuck in their cars or realized they needed to go in the water, in the ocean, to escape the fires. Because some people I know, a friend of mine was helping a newly homeless woman who had been in the water for 8 hours before she was rescued. Just imagine that, 8 hours in the water. And the only reason that she didn't get hypothermia, as you would even in the water in Hawaii, was that the fires were so hot that they actually heated up the water. But it was the biggest disaster that Hawaii has ever seen. It was following Pearl Harbor, it was pretty much the biggest disaster we've ever had in Hawaii. And even though Hawaii, here in Maui, we have a very large integrated outdoor siren warning system with over 80 sirens on Maui alone that are meant to be used in cases of natural disaster. For whatever reason, local officials decided not to sound the sirens. So that is, you know, there's a lot of controversy over that. A lot of residents feel that that might have made a very big difference if the sirens had been sounded. So
CJ, can I break in a minute? You just said something that is making me think. So Hawaii is an island and it's surrounded by bodies of water. And you said that the fire was so hot and so intense that rather than the water, the natural waters cooling the fire heated up the water.
That's right. Well, if you were close to shore, I mean, further away, that wasn't the case, but close to shore. But that's how some of these people managed to survive without getting hypothermia after having been in the water for several hours before being rescued.
Wow. Thank you.
And, you know, the death toll is officially it's around 115, but a lot of the bodies cannot be identified. And there are a lot of people missing. The count of missing people has fluctuated from 2000 to 350 but it's very, very hard to know because there are also a lot of homeless people in Lahaina, and those people will have no friends and family who would have reported them missing. So it's a very, very difficult situation. And in terms of the number of dead, it's going to be probably impossible to identify most of the bodies there because they were some of them were just, it's just ash, basically. It's very, very difficult, and they've got forensic teams going in there right now, but they've actually said that they want DNA samples from friends and from relatives in order to be able to identify some of the bodies. But there have been such amazing stories of resilience, of how the island has all the people in the island, how they've come together to help the fire victims. And it's really amazing. There was one story that I heard. I need to give a shout out to a nun at the Jodo Mission, which is a Buddhist temple in Lahaina. And she's a Korean nun, and she was compelled to stay in the temple, even though it was burning. She wanted to rescue the Buddha. And despite the fact that the temple area was filled with smoke and she could hardly see, she managed to rescue this wooden Buddha and take it to safety. And it was a very selfless act. She wasn't concerned about her personal safety. And in fact, it's the second time that the temple has burned down. It burned down in 1968 and was rebuilt in 1970. And at that time, a different person rescued the Buddha from the temple. And so the Buddha survived. And so yet again, this Buddha, this wooden Buddha has survived, and they're going to rebuild that temple with the Buddha in it. But the Korean nun didn't want her name given out. She was very modest, but she braved the fire just to rescue the Buddha statue. So, and you find all kinds of stories like that of people who, against their own personal safety, they did things that they felt were for the higher good. And to me, that was a very empowering story. But there's a news clip that I'd like to show of a wonderful ceremony that was done in Waikiki, a paddle out to honor all the people that died in the fire. In the fires on Maui. So I'd like to go to that.
Now, tensions rising in Hawaii after another fire broke out in Maui, prompting evacuations. Sam Brock is there for us. And Sam, this time warning sirens did sound, right?
Yeah, that's right, Kate. The sirens were activated around 1:30 p.m. yesterday afternoon, perhaps a reflection of the lessons learned. I'm standing right now on a hillside where the brush fire swept through. Look at this. Look at the footprint and how close it came to homes, Kate. The reason that this earth I'm standing on is black right now is because the grass burned. It came right up to the bushes. There's a charred tree. It was virtually on the doorstep of all of these homes. Now, this video shows plumes of smoke and flames as residents are fleeing under a go now evacuation order. That is about a mile and a half outside of Lahaina Town. This woman was being interviewed as sirens started blaring.
You've lost your jobs because your business is gone. So, hi. I've got to go. I have staff members that are in Kahanapali and they need to be evacuated. So I must go and evacuate more staff right now.
Okay.
Thank you so much. Yeah. Word out.
The evacuation order was ultimately lifted after about 3.5 hours, but West Maui right now is bone dry and windy, meaning this could go on for days or even weeks.
Well, actually, that was a second fire that happened in near Kaanapali, I believe, and I was told that the fire that they actually did sound the sirens that time. They were sounded 5 times, and they had the effect that they were supposed to. People actually evacuated and listened to the listened to the sirens. So there you go. So who do we invite to the show today to share their empowering story, Sabrina?
CJ, we're very honored. Our first guest is Paul DeLores, an author and consultant with 36 years experience as a director of the political action organization, the Maui Pono Network. In 2018, he helped usher in a progressive majority in Maui County. Paul coordinated 287 grassroots groups that were focused on change. He has a book, and it's called Common Sense: How We're Reclaiming Democracy and Resetting for the Common Good. Can't wait to hear from Paul. Our second guest is Ed Ellsworth. Ed is a video producer who has lived in Pau, Maui since 1991 after working in Switzerland on a solar project with the Stirling Engine. He has worked with the U.S. Navy on documenting the cleanup of Kohu-Awalo. And you know, I'm not Hawaiian, so I hope I'm not tearing these names
well,
up.
Well, Ed comes from Paia, and he documented the cleanup of Ka'o'olawe, which is a Hawaiian island near Maui, which and produced a video called Protective Works.
Well, thank you for bailing me out of that, CJ. Ed was also involved in placing private radiation detection networks in the Chernobyl in Japan after the, help me out with this, CJ.
Fukushima disaster.
Fukushima disaster. Coming from our former British BBC correspondent, she gets these names. I appreciate my co-host here. Ed is also working to improve access to clean water in Maui in the aftermath of the wildfires. And our final guest is Steve Phillips, a Hawaiian representative for PROUT, the Progressive Utilization Theory Organization. Steve worked with cooperatives for 22 years on the mainland, and 12 years ago, he started Local Harvest on Maui with the purpose of building up the local food supply. For the past few years, his organization has been working closely with Hungry Heroes Hawaii, providing local produce for hundreds of meals for the homeless. The Local Harvest Food Hub now supplies local produce to the stores and restaurants on Maui, and most of the nonprofits for preparing meals for the people displaced for the Lahaina fires. We will get a chance to meet our guest after our YouTube break. But before we go to break, we want to thank our host and resident of Hawaii, Miss CJ Grace, for making this possible and for bringing enlightenment and encouragement and empowerment to this very tragic event that is occurring in the state of Maui and the other islands of Hawaii. We certainly want to thank you, Ms. CJ.
Yes, and what we're going to be seeing is that empowering event I was speaking about earlier that happened on, and this one happened on August 19th, day one of Duke's Ocean Fest in Honolulu, Hawaii, with what was supposed to be the Red Bull Party Wave event in Waikiki. But instead, hundreds gathered and paddled out to show support for their neighbor island, Maui, following the devastating fire in Lahaina. So, we'll be seeing that in just a moment, but don't forget that Empowering Maui is supported by Thriving Women Network, a franchise media network that supports organizations like Hungry Heroes Hawaii. Take a moment and visit their website at hhhmaui.org and support the movement of change.
Welcome back to our special on Empowering Maui, sponsored by the Thriving Women Network. We're excited to have in our studio Ed Ellsworth. He is a video producer and he's lived in Paia, Maui since 1991. This is not new to Ed. He's worked with the U.S. Navy on documenting a cleanup work in a neighboring island near Maui. He's produced a video called The Protective Works. He was involved in placing private radiation detection networks in Chernobyl and in Japan after the Fukushima disaster. Currently, Ed is working to improve access to clean water in Maui in the aftermath of these wildfires. So, Ed, welcome, welcome, welcome.
Well, aloha, Sabrina. Thank you very much.
Well, so, I have a few questions to ask you before you get started.
Please go ahead.
Okay, so Ed, before we begin our conversation on this very tragic event, tell our viewers about your passion and videoing content on the important events that should empower others to action.
Well, I think it's important to be, especially in these times, be in service to others. And video is such a powerful tool to be able to let people know about what's going on in the world. So it's an easy way. It's one of the easier ways to amplify and share your message out there with the world and hopefully educate people on what the issues are that you're concerned about.
And of course, Ed, if we didn't have those videos, we wouldn't be empowered or informed, such as the videos that we just saw. So we appreciate your really great work. And we're going to delve a little bit more into this, the water and the quality of water. And you're going to tell us about something too as well. So Ed, there are a lot of perspectives on the origin of the fire. We know that. But when did you hear about the events that were taking place? And how did it impact the water quality of Kula and Lahaina?
Well, of course, right after the really intense raging fires, of course, we were concerned about people's loss of life, loss of their homes, loss of access to the roads because power poles and trees were down in the road and blocking the way. But then the Hawaii State Department of Health declared an unsafe water advisory for the Upper Kula areas and for Lahaina. And if you can imagine these really, really intense raging fires melting down plastics and petrochemicals and all those things going into the water table. So the Department of Health has been concerned about the VOCs, the volatile organic compounds that have been going into the water system. These include benzene, terlene, and xylenes. So the unsafe water advisory is not just the drinking water. They're being advised not to use hot water, not to even bathe in the water. So that's really impacted people for the last few weeks where they can't even if they have their home and that's intact, they can't drink the water in the tap, they can't take a shower. That means they have to make other arrangements to live their life.
I have to go back to something you just said, because we get water alerts here in Florida, but they say, well, you can boil the water. Are you saying that not even hot water is usable?
Well, no. If you can imagine these compounds that are petrochemicals and plastics melting from the fires and going into the water system, heating them probably just flares them up or makes them more accessible to cell membranes in your body. So you don't want that to be going onto your skin or going into your stomach. So this is something that they can't filter out. This is not something that this is not a advisory that they removed. It's still in place. There's not safe drinking water. That means that people have to go out and get bottled water, and they're brushing their teeth with bottled water, and they're sponge bathing, or they're going to Seabury Hall to use community showers in an area that's safe, that's not that doesn't have the VOCs in the water system.
And that was my next question. So if they have this water that's not usable, where are they getting the usable water that they can drink, that they can shower with, that they can cook with?
Well, that means for most of these people, they're having to drive 20 or 30 minutes away from their home to some other location to buy, to either buy bottled water or to bring 5-gallon jugs and have them filled up at some safe water location.
Mm-mm-mm. And so how instrumental are you in that? I think you said you had something there I'm staring at.
Well, yeah. I've done to be proactive about some kind of solution is to bring in a couple of these Condor water filters, especially after I heard that when they were distributing potable water in the County of Maui water tank trucks that were going up to the Kula area and to the Lahaina area, I had some reports that people drank that water and they got sick. So sometimes what happens in these big tank trucks is the water that's been sitting in there gets bacteria or sometimes microorganisms. So this type of commercial filter that's over my shoulder here will filter those types of materials out of the water to make it safe to drink. And they've been used successfully in South America and other locations where there's been water quality issues. But unfortunately, they're not able to filter out the VOCs, the volatile organic compounds that are creating the unsafe water and drinking conditions.
Wow, I'm so happy that you're here, because stateside, that's not even something that I was thinking about, was the quality of water. Yeah. You know, we see the fires, but we don't think about the quality of the water and it being potentially poisonous. Another devil devastation. So we're really happy. And this is what Thriving Women Network is all about. It's about providing these empowering, encouraging, and enlightening messages to people around the world. And with that being said, Ed, is there anything that you want to share with us in addition to the water issue or, you know, adding to that, that would help the people in Hawaii thrive?
Mostly what people need right now are distribution of clean water and food, and the next organization that you're going to feature is very instrumental in that. So please donate to groups like that. And if you're interested in any updates that I might be putting forward, you're welcome to tune into my website, enlightenedfilms.com.
Beautiful, beautiful. And so, Ed, you mentioned donating to various organizations there locally. Is there anything else that you can think of that we could do to help the island of Hawaii?
Just keep us in your prayers and start reconsidering the idea of vacationing in Maui. When this initially happened, the governor and other officials warned people to stay away. And now that's impacting the economy of the island greatly. So they're encouraging people to come visit. Don't forget that, you know, Maui's a beautiful place to come and de-stress from the mainland, whatever's going on there, and the local economy needs your support.
Well, thank you. And you heard it from Ed Ellsworth. Ed, how can we support your vision and your mission of what you're doing with the water? How can we support you? You mentioned we can tune into your video. How can we find you and support you?
I will be posting more information on my website, enlightenedfilms.com. And if you're able to give to any of the groups that I list there, or if you're able to donate anything to bring more of these Condor water filters over, that'll be much appreciated. I'd like to get them distributed in the community. Right now, I'm just targeting the water quality in Kula after some testing at the University of Hawaii at Maui campus. We'll know how effective they are. I'd also like to get as many as I can over to the Lahaina area.
Ed, are those available for the United States?
Yes, they are. They're produced in Berkeley, California, actually.
Okay, I'd be interested in looking into that a little bit more.
The company is called Agua Munda, but I'll be putting references to that on the page that you see on my website.
Beautiful. Thank you so much, Ed. Thank you.
So welcome back to Empowering Maui, sponsored by Thriving Women Network. We want to thank our guests, Steve Phillips, Ed Ellsworth, and Paul Delorier, for joining us today from Maui to share their passion and to talk about how to empower struggling families in Hawaii. So where do we go from here? How can you assist families in need? Well, local organizations are the best to donate, as they are sure to get the funds directly to those who need it. Two Maui organizations pledge to use 100% of your donations for community needs, and your gift to them will be tax deductible. And these two organizations are the Maui Community Foundation, Maui Strong Fund. And the website for that is www.hawaiicommunityfoundation.org/Maui-strong. That's hawaiicommunityfoundation.org/Maui-strong. That gets you to the Maui Strong Fund of the Maui Community Foundation. And the second organization is Hungry Heroes Hawaii. And their website, you can see that, is hhhmaui.org/take-action. So hhhmaui.org. And to volunteer your time or give a tax-deductible donation to Hungry Heroes Hawaii, all you have to do is visit that website, hhhmaui.org. Every dollar you donate is guaranteed to help those in need rather than going to administration or salaries, unlike what happens with many large national charities.
Wow. CJ, I certainly want to thank you for bringing this to light. You are boots on the ground right there in Hawaii. You're seeing this firsthand. And so we appreciate the resources that you've brought to us, the contacts that you've brought to us, our guests that came and shared their expertise and how they're helping Maui Strong and what we can do. Thriving Women Network encourages all of our international guests to help make Maui strong. As you can see, there's a clean water supply issue, food pantries, all types of things that are going on there. So there's room for you to do what you can to support this effort. So we certainly appreciate what you've done for us, CJ. Thank you.
Thank you. For giving me the opportunity to put this out. Very important.
It's very important. Now, we know there's devastation going on all over the world, and we at Thriving Women Network want to cover those things. So please, if there's something that you're aware of out there, please drop us a line at thrivingwomennetwork.com. That's thrivingwomennetwork.com. That's our website. If there's something that we need to feature, we need to know about, but we want to make sure whatever we do, it encourages, it enlightens, and it empowers our neighbors globally. So please let us know. And as mentioned, Empowering Maui is sponsored by Thriving Women Network, a franchise media network that supports organizations like Maui Strong Fund. Take a moment and visit their website at hawaiicommunityfoundation.org. And I think you saw that a tag about that earlier, and support the change that is needed. But until then, CJ Grace and myself want to bid you farewell. You can catch this on E360 TV and Spotify if you've missed it. But please, let's unite and keep Maui strong. We'll see you next time.